Psalm 104. If you don't have a King James Bible, there's going to be an usher by your side in just a moment. We want you to have a Bible. We're going to sing out of it and preach out of it. And you're going to get a whole lot more from the service if you have your own copy of the Bible. If you don't own a King James Bible, if you don't have one at home, but you say, Pastor, if I had one, I'd do my very best to read it, even just 5 or 10 minutes a day. I'll do my best to read it every day. You see us after the service today. Say, can I have a Bible? Can I please have a Bible? And we'll get a brand new one for you to take home. Psalm 104:33, together.
I will sing unto the Lord as long as I live. I will sing praise to my God while I have my being. My meditation of him shall be sweet, and I will be glad. I will be glad in the Lord. Oh, bless thou the Lord. Oh, my soul, praise ye the Lord. Oh, bless thou the Lord. Oh, my soul, praise ye the Lord. Oh, bless thou the Lord. Oh, my soul, praise ye the Lord. Bless thou the Lord, oh my soul.
That part in parentheses for the ladies to sing an echo.
I will sing unto the Lord as long as I live, and I will sing praise to my God while I have my being.
Good, thank you.
My meditation of him shall be sweet, and I will be glad. I will be glad in the Lord.
Bless thou the Lord.
Bless thou the Lord. Oh, my soul, praise ye the praise ye the Lord. Bless thou the Lord. Oh, my ladies, praise the Lord. Bless thou the Lord. Oh, my soul, praise ye the Lord. Oh, bless thou the Lord, oh my soul, praise the Lord.
Well, we're getting ready today. Today is called Preparation for Our Purpose. Yeah. Preparation for Our Purpose. Next Sunday begins our missions revival. Amen. And whether you realize it or not, that is the purpose for our existence as a church. Not just for us to meet here, and I thank God for all of you that come, and I'm very, very grateful for your attentiveness to the Word of God, for your hunger for the Word of God, but our purpose of existence is to take the gospel to every creature, to the uttermost parts of the earth. I mean, just look at a map and look at the corners and way far away. We are to take the gospel to the uttermost parts of the world. And so today, I want to prepare you as best the Lord would enable me, prepare you for next Sunday. And now listen, some of these missionaries, now some are veterans, and but others are brand new to this. Yeah. Encourage them. Yeah. And tonight on Sunday nights, we have our, I call them preacher boys, but I shouldn't call them preacher boys because they're some of them are men, but they are people that do not necessarily preach every week. They don't have a preaching position, but they are preaching. And we want you to get to know them and to hear them and get them the practice of standing before ugly people so they can do it. The Bible says, don't be afraid for their faces. So lighten up. Smile. Nod your head when somebody is preaching. You have to do it for mine. If you only get so many nods per day, don't worry about giving them to me. Give them tonight. To the preacher boy, and then to Brother Ryan Gray when he brings the message tonight. And then next week, when these missionaries are here, let them know that you're interested. Greet them by name. Are there pictures in today's bulletin? So get to know them. Start praying for them now. And it's a wonderful privilege we have way up here in the far north to have these missionaries that come all this way to share their burden with us, and they're looking to get into our pocketbooks as well. They're looking for money, because it takes money to go to the mission field. And I'll show you that in the Bible in just a minute. So we're going to prepare for our purpose. In Romans chapter 10, We all know verse 13. I want you to start at verse 8. Romans chapter 10 and verse 8. I'll read aloud while you read silently, please, if you would. But what saith it? The word is nigh thee, even in thy mouth and in thy heart. That is, the word of faith which we preach. Now, by the way, I have great confidence that when I stand to preach, that the word of God, the word of faith, is already in your heart and in your mind and on your mouth. That you have already taken some steps of faith. If you're saved, you took the first step of faith to receive the Lord Jesus Christ as Savior. Now, if you're here today and you're not saved, the word of faith is nigh thee, even in thy mouth. God's more interested in saving you than you could ever want to be saved yourself. Saved from what, preacher? Saved from hell. Saved from yourself. Saved from your sin. He is the Savior. And if you die without a Savior, you spend eternity in hell, burning in a flame of fire where the worm is dieth not, where the fire is never quenched. Apart from God, you live in eternity the same way you wanted to live down here, without God. Don't play the fool. Don't play the fool. Only a fool would say, I don't care, I'll go to hell. God put fire in hell so that you would flee hell and run to the Savior. So, we're back to Romans chapter 10. The word which we preach, verse 9. That if thou shalt confess with thy mouth the Lord Jesus, and believe in thine heart that God hath raised him from the dead, thou shalt be saved. For with the heart man believeth unto righteousness, and with the mouth confession is made unto salvation. For the scripture saith, whosoever believeth on him shall not be ashamed. For there is no difference between the Jew and the Greek, for the same Lord over all is rich unto all that call upon him. For whosoever shall call upon the name of the Lord shall be saved. Amen. Now how then shall they call on him and whom they have not, what's the next word, class? Believed. How can they, you call to be saved, but how can you call upon him until you believed? And how shall they believe in him of whom they have not heard? And how shall they hear without a preacher? And how shall they preach except they be sent? That's where the finances come in sending them. As it is written, how beautiful are the feet of them which preach the gospel of peace, that bring glad tidings of good things. Amen. But they have not all obeyed the gospel. For Isaiah saith, Lord, who hath believed our report? So then, let's read verse 17 aloud together. So then, faith cometh by hearing, and hearing by the word of God. Again, so then, faith cometh by hearing, and hearing by the word of God. Let your Bible just stay open there, please, if you would. May God bless the reading and hearing and preaching of the word of God. Listen, there's some things you've got to understand. Now, some of this may be kindergarten to those of you that have been around for a long time. But if you've been around for a long time, your heart will rejoice when you hear them. We're preparing ourselves for next week, because God wants every believer in the ministry. In the ministry. Now, you got to understand the ministry. The ministry is to help people believe on the Lord Jesus. Man, it doesn't feel good today. And man, it's, you just, as the Bible said, just sleep on. Just rest. I'll try to put you to sleep, and we'll try to let you rest. I was hoping he'd go home and just rest today. There's a bug going around. You know what I mean? And you say, I don't want to catch that bug. You don't catch the bug. The bug catches you. You get under stress, overwork, which never happens anywhere around here. But you don't eat right. You don't get enough sleep. Then you get weak, and then the bug catches you. Then I'll tell you, some of these bugs are hard to get rid of, hard to get over. So I appreciate Manus being here today, but we're not expecting anything from you, okay? You just rest and stay well, because we need you desperately next week in the ministry. Yeah. Now, so the ministry involves, there's a lot of things that go on around here that are not under the category of ministry. They're necessary, but they're not ministry. They're a service to the Lord, a service to the local church. For instance, we have two men up there that are doing the sound. Now, I'm glad that they're there. They can make my life miserable and usually do. But things are well. Things are well today. Just don't touch anything. Just leave it right where it's at. And but that's not a ministry. That's a service to us. The folks that are running the camera for the live stream, that's a service, but it's not a ministry. There are people watching the nursery, and aren't you glad? If they let all those children out of that nursery and they were to come in here right now, the Bible has a word for that. It's called Great Tribulation. You know what I mean? I mean, it would be unbelievable. Thank God for them. But that's a service. The ministry involves the Word of God. The word that is nigh thee, even in thy mouth, that word which we preach. And really, God wants everybody involved in the ministry at some extent. When you take the gospel out, that's the ministry. When you give out a gospel tract with the gospel, that's a ministry. Those that teach Sunday school classes, they're in the ministry. And thank God for that. We ought to be all looking for the ministry that God has for us. You don't just join a church to sit and sour. Hey, this is not a social club. That is a nightclub, but we don't meet at night. But this is not a social club. You don't join for status. You join to serve. I remember when I was in Bible college and I had already graduated, and so Cindy and I moved out towards the country, out of Springfield, and we joined a little country church out there to see if we could be a help. When we walked down the aisle and joined the church, we were met with a layman in the church that had a notepad and said, "Now, what do you want to do here?" I don't even know everybody's name yet. But you don't have to know everybody's name. You just have to have a heart to serve the God of heaven and get a ministry. You say, "Well, I don't know enough about the Bible." Hey, listen to me. You're going to learn more from the Bible when you teach the Bible. Nobody knows all there is to know. And Jesus said, "Take my yoke upon me." A yoke is for service. Take my yoke upon and learn of me. I am meek and lowly of heart. In other words, you'll get to know the Lord when you put his yoke on you and decide to minister the Bible. "Oh, I don't know enough about the Bible." You can't teach a second grade class. Well, you help me. You could surely study enough in the week to know what to say to the kids in the second grade. Evil communication corrupts good habits. Stop not talking like that. If you're saved, you can minister the Word of God. You can help people. Now, you're going to learn better how to do it as time goes on. What if we started, let's have a new service started around here. Let's start the BBC Fire Department. You know, buildings burn down. And this building could burn down. When we were down in the old building, we used to have three preaching services on Sunday morning at the old building. One at 8:30, then one at 10, then one at 11:30. That'd drive a sane man crazy. I'd get up to preach and think, "Have I ever given this illustration? Have I already read that scripture? Have I already given that announcement already?" And I still do that now, but for different reasons. But I told the people, if this place catches on fire, just quietly walk out of the building. If I find anybody dials 911, I'm going to smack you in the head. Just let it burn down. Now, we went on record as saying that, so we couldn't do that. But the insurance money would have helped us. you know what I mean? Don't look at me like that. Come on, you've had those thoughts yourself. Back in the old-timey days when they used to fetch their water from the watering hole, the church building caught on fire. The whole community was out running with buckets to get water from the watering hole and dumping it on the church building. And everybody was out to try to save the building. Lo and behold, here comes the deacon of the church, and he's getting water right alongside the town atheist. And the deacon says, under his breath, as they're running together side by side, "I bet this is the first time," the deacon said, "that this town's ever seen you running to the church." And he said, "This is the first time this town has ever seen the church on fire." So, if the church gets on fire for the Lord, things are going to happen. folks might just, folks who visit might just imagine that we mean what we say. So we're going to start a BBC fire department. Now, you know, I never have been in the fire department. Joe Mister is going to be here in a couple of weeks, by the way. Joe Mister works for the fire department in Juneau, and I wouldn't mind some things. Anyway, never mind. Forget I even thought that, but I did think it. So I'm going to ask some folks to help me. Craig Halpin's way back there in the back. Now, you don't have to say anything necessarily, but you have to nod. Somebody, if you notice these fire trucks that go through town, they're all nice and shiny. But when they put out a fire, they get all wet and muddy and sometimes ice on them. So somebody, when you get back to the station house, somebody has to clean them up and keep them shiny. Craig, would you be willing to do that for us? Okay? We need a fire department, but we need somebody, too, to help us keep the fire engines looking nice. Just look. I say fire engines, fire trucks, and the distinction, but I don't know what that is. So then I need somebody to keep the place clean. You've got things decently in order, and somebody has to keep this place clean. Mrs. Gibson, Lonnie Gibson, would you help us with that? Would you do that? Would you help us? All right. So the break room needs to be kept clean and everything, and the people spend the night there, so everything, you got to keep everything clean. And so she's volunteering to do that. I appreciate that very much. And JP, where's JP turn? Hey, JP's right there. Somebody has to clean the hoses and make sure the hoses are repaired. So you go out to a fire and you come back and they're just a mess. So somebody has to clean them and make sure they're repaired, ready for the next time. Are you willing to do that? Okay, JP's willing to do that. Mrs. Gibson, you're willing to keep the place clean? All right, and Craig, you're willing to help keep the fire trucks shiny. Hello? That's true. All right. So we're going to start the BBC fire department. And now, obviously, our purpose is to fight fires. But I want to review here just quickly. JP, what's your job? Thank you very much. Craig, what's your job? Thank you. Mrs. Gibson, what's your job? Now, you see, here's what happened. Thank you very much. Your job is to put out fires. You only do the other jobs when you're not putting out fires. That was kind of a trick question. That was kind of an April Fool's weekend, you know what I mean? Just a trick. But in other words, that's your job, is to put out fires. Nobody's going to say, hey, Mrs. Gibson wouldn't say, I can't go help fight the fire. I got to keep this place clean. No, no, you don't have your priorities in the right order. Brother S.M. Davis, now at the men's retreat, preached a sermon. Right priorities will get you out of trouble and keep you out of trouble if you get things in their proper order. And that's true in the local church. I think the reason why somebody preached and why churches have church splits, because our eyes are in the wrong place. You're complaining about the color of walls or the color of carpet or whether we have chairs or whether we have pews. That's a hint. But that's not those are side issues. My wife, you know, we've raised our children. We had six wonderful children. And at one time they were wonderful. Now it's a different story. But we had six wonderful children. Now we have the grandchildren around. And so my wife, she'll be out there in the mornings feeding them breakfast. And your kids are very active. And so while she's feeding them oatmeal for breakfast, they're looking over here. They hear a noise over here. And then here goes the spoon and here goes the oatmeal. And if I've heard my wife say it once, I've heard her say it three times. Keep the main thing the main thing. If this is time to eat, just focus upon eating. You can play later on, but you keep the main thing the main. Let's just say that together. Keep the main thing the main thing. Say it again. Keep the main thing the main thing. Say it again. Keep the main thing the main thing. The main thing for Bible Baptist Church is carrying out the Great Commission. Now, we need to have some folks keep the hoses straight out, need to have some folks to keep the place clean, and some people to keep the buildings, fire trucks shined. But our job is to put out fires. Amen. Our job is to rescue people from the fires of hell. To tell them the penalty of sin has been paid for by a wonderful, wonderful Savior, Amen. The Lord Jesus, who died and then rose again. the third day. This is the day of preparing Bible Baptist Church for our purpose. And the first thing that's going to help you be prepared for our purpose next week is going to be to realize that we have a ministry, and that is the ministry. Everything else is a service. And I thank God for those. I thank God for people who can, you know, you don't even know this, but after every Sunday morning service, Ernie Holt stays here and picks up all your trash, all those snot rags you leave hanging behind, all the notes you've been writing people, writing your shopping list back and forth, all those things left in the pew, he picks them up, straightens up the psalm books, picks up the Bibles. Nobody asked him to do that. He just saw that the fire trucks needed to be shined, so he's going to do that. And I thank God for that. There are people that clean out the buses and gas up the buses. And I mean, I am so grateful for all those services that people provide to Bible Baptist Church, often without even being asked to do it. A need seen is an assignment given. Let's say that. A need seen is an assignment given. Say it again. A need seen is an assignment given. Again, a need seen is an assignment. If you see something that needs to be done, you just got an assignment. Do it. Do it. Take it upon yourself and do it. But while you're going to do those things, realize that every Christian ought to have a ministry for the Lord. You ought to be doing something with the Word of God to reach souls and teach souls. It's a combination. That's the Great Commission. Reach them and teach them. Amen. The church will baptize them. You reach them and teach them. So that's the ministry. And then we have a mission. Now, what is our mission? Our mission is found in verse 13. For whosoever shall call upon, Romans chapter 10. In verse 13, for whosoever shall call upon the name of the Lord shall be saved. Now, how shall they call upon him in whom they have not what? Believed. See, our ministry, our mission is to help them believe. Amen. Now, let me make you mad or make you glad, depending upon what you believe. Our goal in taking the gospel out is not to get people to stop sinning. Not to get people to change their dress code. Not to get people with long hair to cut their hair. That's God's job after they get saved. It's like fishing. We catch them, God cleans them. What do I know about fishing? But anyway, I thought I would just throw that out. Back in the 70s and the 80s, there was preaching going around America and our Baptist churches, called Lordship Salvation. They took the verse, believe on the Lord Jesus Christ, and thou shalt be saved. And they said, unless you make Jesus Christ Lord of your life, you're not saved. Now look at me. Look, take your God-given eyeballs and look up here. There is not a single person in this auditorium that has Jesus Christ as Lord of everything in your life every day. Now you can think that all you want, but you're deceiving yourself. If we say that we have no sin, we make him a liar. Jesus said, why call ye me Lord, Lord, and do not the things which I say? So if he told us to be a witness, and so it's been a long time since you've witnessed, if he told you to tithe and you've not tithed, if he told you not to forsake the assembling of yourselves together and you stroll in here on Sunday morning and we never see you again, I wonder who's Lord of your life. The point is, that's not what saves you. When the Bible says believe on the Lord Jesus Christ, that's his title. He is the Lord Jesus Christ. Do you understand that before you get saved, 1 minute before you get saved, you are dead in trespasses and sins? You have no life in you, no spiritual life. You're dead. The Bible says in Ephesians chapter 2, you're dead in trespasses and sins. Then when you get saved, God's Holy Spirit comes to live inside of you and begins the process of making you a new creature. Hello, class? So until you get saved, you're powerless to stop sinning. Now, you can stop some things, but it's powerless for you to stop sinning because you're dead in sin. You have no power. The power comes when the Savior moves in. Isn't that good? Isn't that good to know? To try to go to a person and to In fact, I said to Jim White, how do you remember Jim White, the evangelist? Oh, yeah. He and I first got acquainted when this Lordship Salvation was running around. And I said to him, do you find that a lot when you're traveling? Oh, it's everywhere, preacher. It's just everywhere. And I said, how do they function believing that? You know what he said to me? He didn't even hesitate. He said, they don't. They lead someone to Christ the same way you and I lead someone to Christ. That's the only way you can lead someone to Christ. Believe on the Lord Jesus Christ and thou shalt be saved. It just makes for good preaching when you tell people, my converts live right and do right in front of you, perhaps. But you don't know the secret of men's hearts. Do you know the Bible says if you have lust in your heart, you've committed adultery already? The thought of foolishness is sin, the Bible says. That all of sin finds its root in your heart. What, it's not what happens to you that defiles you. It's what comes out of your heart that defiles you. Now, I'm all for the Lord Jesus Christ is Lord. And I remember the day when I said, I want you to be the Lord of every area of my life. I didn't succeed in every area, but that's what I wanted to be. But that was years after I got saved. I grew into that position, if you please. Sometimes I fear that we want a brand new Christian to understand all that we think we understand. That we want them to live like we do, and we've been saved for 10 years. Hey, it's a growing process. I watch my little grandchildren learn how to walk. I've never had a single one of them sit in their playpen, look out behind the bars, and say, oh, there goes Daddy. There goes my grandpa walking. I think I'll do that. And he crawled out of there and been walking ever since. That's not what happens. They take a couple of steps and they fall. They get up, take a couple of steps and they fall. That's the picture of the new Christian. Takes a couple of steps and then they fall. The important thing, as long as you get up more times than you fall down, just keep getting back up again. Man looks at how many times you fall. God looks at how many times you get back up. Hey, the righteous man falls 7 times, but he gets back up again. And that's the righteous man who falls 7 times. And so we have a mission, and that mission is to help people believe on the Lord Jesus. In fact, if you'll notice, if you ever read the bulletin, please tell me. I want 200 people to say, oh, yes, I love this bulletin. You put a lot of time and money in this bulletin. Thank you very much. There's a column that says last week's facts. You don't have to take it out. You've already read it. And the top says these souls prayed to receive the Savior. Is Don Silas here? Don, wave to me. Here's Don Silas. What's your relationship to Chuck Doyle, if you don't mind telling everybody? So he's your uncle. Okay. And so Don came up here to live with Chuck Doyle and his wife Shirley, and last Sunday Don prayed to receive Christ as Savior. Now, we don't say these souls got saved last week. That's not what it says. It never says that, because we don't know whether he got saved or not. You ever have someone surprise you and they walked the aisle and they got saved and you thought they were already saved? We don't know that, but we do know this: he prayed to be saved. Now, can I say this to you? So, well, I prayed when I was 4. I'm going to make you mad. A prayer never saved anybody. Just because you ask Jesus to save you does not mean that he saves you. Boy, now that I have your undivided attention, it's not asking, it's believing. It's believing on the Lord Jesus. Now, with the mouth, confession is made. But if that confession hasn't been based upon trusting Christ as Savior, if you're trying to add your works and God's works, your works cancel out God's works. You can't mix the two of them together. Hello, class? And so everybody ought to have a ministry, and the mission of our church is to help people believe in the Lord Jesus. So if we're going to be involved in the Great Commission, we have to recognize our ministry, and all of us have to submit ourselves to the mission. The mission of our church can only be carried out by individual people. Hello? You know, I never leave my house without gospel tracts in my pocket. One time I came out, I was only headed to church, I only live a couple of blocks away, and I ran back in to get some tracts, and Cindy said, what did you forget? I said, I forgot my tracts. I changed port coats and I forgot my tracts. And she said, you're only going to go to church? They don't need them over there. I said, you never, first of all, that's a lie, but anyway, you never know. After church, she could say, oh, Doug, could you stop by the store and get some milk? Oh, yes, I will. And then there's an opportunity to give a gospel tract and the gospel. In fact, somebody in the line at Walmart, not that there's ever a line at the cash registers. You know, Walmart was having a hard time financially, and they announced that they're going to have to close in the country. They're going to close 50 stores. But that would require them laying off 14 cashiers. And so they changed their mind. But Brother Maynard was in line over there and was talking to this person in front of him and asked him where they go to church and what have you. He gave her a gospel tract. And she looked at it, and then after a while, she said, while they're waiting in line, she said, can I have another one of those? I'd like to give that to my mother to read. I mean, have you ever been asked for a gospel tract? See, if witnessing is a way of life for you, if everywhere you go, the benefit of carrying gospel tracts all the time is that I'm always on the lookout as to who to give them to. And you know, now you think of how many years I've been here, how many gospel tracts I've given out. I can count on one hand the time they were thrown back in my face. I went to the post office one time, and I gave them a chick track. This is a real good chick track, I think. It says, who is he? And so I wasn't that one, but I gave the chick track to this lady. She was hostile. She was hostile, but she was a good shot. She threw it over her shoulder into the trash can. Said, don't give that stuff out around here. Now, there's no sense getting mad. It doesn't help you to get mad. So I said, oh, ma'am, I wouldn't have offended you on purpose for anything. That cost me 10 cents. Do you mind if I get it back? And they had just emptied the trash. So she had to go way down in that trash can to find that gospel tract. That's sort of a Christian form of revenge. I probably shouldn't have done it. I probably shouldn't have done it, but it sure was. She was a short lady, too, so I was watching her trying to get all the way to the bottom of that trash can. Just simple joys in life. You know what I mean? Just simple joys. You ought to be involved in a ministry. The ministry involves giving out the Word of God. And then you ought to be part of the mission. The mission of our church is to help people believe on the Lord Jesus. You know, they may need help. You know, it may be hard for you to believe unless you've done a lot of soul winning. There are some people who have never prayed out loud in their whole life. They may have said some silent prayers, but they never have opened their mouth and prayed out loud. They never have prayed in front of somebody else. But we're going to ask them to, and we give them the gospel if they want to be saved. And by the way, that's the kind of the key. After you give the gospel, you need to ask them if they want to be saved, if they want to receive the Lord. Otherwise, it's like fishing, putting your hook out there, but then when you get a bite, you just throw it back in. I know people who do that. They're called catch and release. That's not for the Christian. It's not catch and release. It's catch and keep. So you have a ministry, and then you need to be part of the mission. But then this great commission, according to Romans chapter 10, how shall they hear without a preacher? Listen, class, we need manpower. You got to realize what the ministry is. You have to be part of the mission, and then we need manpower. You need preachers. You need to have people that you send out soul winning, people that you send overseas to go plant churches, make disciples and plant churches. Hello? Yeah, you have to. Now, for this manpower, if you're a member of our church, you need to get enlisted. You need to enlist in the project. Brother, it'll come to me. Just don't push me. Don't hurry me. Brother Michael Fairchild, my dear friend, whose birthday just happened this week. Anyway, Now I got to remember what I was going to tell you about Michael Fairchild. So many memory things I have to say all at one time. But he said, when you get saved, you're part of the Lord's army. But when you join this church, it's like being in the special forces. Because God has given to us a clear vision. Now, there's something, this ought to break your heart. Do you realize that half the world has never heard the gospel? Half the world. Now, by the way, that was true when I first came here 41 years ago. Half the world, I said it back then, half the world never heard the gospel. Guess what? 40 years later, half the world has never heard the gospel. They have no Bible. They have no Christian radio station. They have nothing. That's why I get aggravated when missionaries call me on the phone and they want to go to England and preach the gospel. England, they're not interested in the gospel. You say, well, shouldn't we tell people who aren't interested? Yeah, but do that on your own dime. Go on vacation over there and witness to people. Then we got our Bible from England. Thank God for that. The first missionaries really came out of England. But now they're cold as a cucumber. They don't want to hear the gospel. But half the world, listen, half the world would believe if somebody told them. That's what we're finding in Malawi. The Fulfords going to Malawi. They're looking for some help to go over there and help with the children's ministry over there. People are believing by the scores because they've never heard. Amen. Never heard. And so here a guy called me this week. God's called me to Canada. I said, Canada? Canada? You want to reach the heathen in Canada? They're there. The heathen are there, but they don't want to hear the gospel. You can go to Canada. Now, any Canadians here? All right, if you know it's true. You go to Canada, you can spend 20 years of your life there, have a church of 75 or 80 people who have no interest in reaching anybody else with the gospel. They are selfish. They are self-centered. They're hard-hearted. You say, you can't paint that with a broad brush. Well, I just did. Do you know if you have a church over 200 in Canada, that's a massive church? And they have Bible colleges. And so one guy wants, if I'm lying, I'm dying. He wants to go there and build a Christian radio station. And he wants people in America to finance that. And I said to him, have you ever heard of the internet? Canada has the internet. I can give you right now 6 independent Baptist radio stations that preach the gospel 24/7 over the internet. You can listen to it for free on your phone. Hello. Hello. You say, well, don't you think God could have called me there? I think God could have, but I doubt that he did. I said, I think you're going there because you know the language already, eh? It's easy. The climate is somewhat decent. What are we doing choosing the mission field based upon the climate? I don't like being cold. I don't like being cold either. So therefore, I stay warm. You know, my family first came here, 1975. You know, the first thing that they did was Mrs. Barstow. She's still here. She go to junior church. You know, the first thing, now we didn't have a large church. There were about 35 people here. You know what they did? They took us to the store and bought winter clothes for all my family. Now, we had already bought winter clothes on the lower 48, but they're not the same. You know what I mean? You know, fleece lined or something. Yeah, but anyway, here's what they said. If you are not warm, you're not going to stay. And they wanted a preacher who would stay. And so they bought us nice warm clothes. I only had one child back then. And since then, they took me out one time and bought me boots, which I don't wear boots, but because I stay where it's warm. When I go out visiting in a house, I leave the car running out in the street. I go inside the house and I come back out and get in the warm car. This only makes sense. And that helps the economy of the state because we live on the oil. So it just helps everybody. You need to just joining a church. Listen, class, when you join a church, that means I want to serve the Lord here. Amen. Get enlisted in the membership and then get enlisted in the ministry here. Find something to do. You know, my heart goes out to those of you that work at the mine. if anybody here works at the mine. I don't know. You get big paychecks, but I don't know if you do much work out there. But, and you guys that do military that work shift work. And I see Brother Searles back there. He was back there. Where's Brother Searles? Sir, you're never going to learn. People just can't step out. Searles, if you're listening to me, Sergeant, you need to be in the auditorium. You're not going to learn anything walking around the hallways looking important. You can walk, but it's going to be a hard job to look important. You know, I've listened live stream when I'm traveling. I listen live stream, but it's not the same as being here. And here's what I thought. And I've said for years, I feel sorry for those guys because they can't be involved in the ministry. That's a lie. I told myself a lie. Let me just throw this out to you, hoping that you will do the same. What if you got together with somebody else on the opposite shift, and you decided to have a ministry as a team? You could take a bus route as a team. You could take a Sunday school class as a team. And the Sundays that you were there, you would teach. And the Sundays that you had to work, they would teach. And then when you get together, don't play video games. Pray for your class. Talk about your class. Make your plans for the class. Hello? You say, would that really work? Do you know the largest Sunday school class that we have of youngsters? That's how they built that class? That's Dean Ojala in the high school class. Dean works shift work, so he and Brother Drops, Jared Drops, and his son Michael, not Jared's son Michael, Dean's son Michael, they, as a team, they taught that class. You see, it's really in desire, isn't it? You say, well, I don't have time to teach. Let me say this to you, just in case you're not mad enough already. You have time to do everything you want to do. Everybody does what they want to do. I'm too busy. Then what you're saying is God gave you too much to do that you can't serve him in the local church. No, that's a lie. That's just a lie. When we go into what they call closed countries where you can't go there as a missionary, then you got to be creative. Brother Kofer and his wife were here two weeks ago. They went in. She makes pottery. One of them makes pottery. The other one paints the pottery. Pottery makers. But that got them in the country because they want pottery painters. They want pottery people who can paint. And so now listen, if you're going to do that, then go make pottery and paint. Go in the country and have integrity. Do what you say you're going to do. But while you're doing that, be a witness to the people. You know, it's strange. We do this, Brother Gray. We say, we're going to support church planters. We want you to go in there and plant a church. But really, let me just spark your brain. That doesn't say that in the Bible. It says go into all the world and preach the gospel. Some places, the foreigner cannot start a church. But if you win people to Christ and then show them in the Bible, they can start their own church. Now, which is more productive? Because if they close and kick out all the pottery painters and you have to leave, they're still going to go on because they're there. What I'm simply saying to you is that all of us need to get enlisted in the membership. Don't just join and sit and sour. Get involved to do something for the Lord. Get involved in the ministry and then get involved in the mission of the church, which, of course, is the Great Commission. Do you know they took a survey of hundreds and hundreds of missionaries? And here was the question. When did you first feel called or prompted towards the mission field? You may be surprised. Between 10 and 12 years of age. That sounds like bus route age to me. That sounds like Sunday school age to me. So that, you know, D.L. Moody was led to Christ by a cobbler. Somebody on the job who just witnessed and wanted to reach kids. Thank God for that. When I surrendered, I was in the Army. We got transferred to Anchorage in the military. And so I found my first Bible-believing church there, first fundamental church, first experience in learning how to do soul winning. And we were just in seventh heaven. We loved it. But then God began doing a stirring in my soul that God wanted me to give him my life, that God was calling me to preach. I remember I was at this altar. I was weeping. My wife didn't know what was happening. She got alongside of me. Doug, are you okay? I could hardly talk. I was so overwhelmed with the emotion. But while I was kneeling there at the altar, God brought back to my mind an event that happened to me shortly after I got saved at this liberal church in New England. We were there standing out by the fence while so the deacons could get a smoke between Sunday school and church. And I owned one suit, the black suit, suitable for funerals or weddings. And somebody, an older person, came by our gathering out there in the front walkway, and she stopped and she said, "Doug, you look like a preacher." Went right over my head. But when I was kneeling at that altar of surrender, God brought that very event back to my mind. I told that to the 8:30 service. So I was sitting in the front row, and some young kid, I didn't know, this is a shame, I didn't know who it was. Don't fault me. I didn't know who Ernie was this morning. I don't know who Michael Fairchild was. I don't know. Something happens. I'm not even 70 yet. I'm a long ways from 70. A couple of weeks. But I don't know, just my memory, just something is happening. And this morning, I was so dizzy. I just having an interesting day. But you just go on. And so he came up to me, and he had on a vest, and maybe it's your son. He had on a red tie, and he looked sharp. And so I remember what the preacher said this morning at 8:30. I remembered what the preacher said at 8:30. And I shook his hands and I said, "You look like a preacher." And he said, "A preacher?" This is what he did. "A preacher? I look like a preacher. Shake my hand." And I shook his hand. Now, if Jesus tarries, I don't know what God has for him. Anybody know who that was? A nice, handsome vest and a red tie. But I hope someday when he goes to an altar at a missions conference, or some other time and just surrenders to the Lord, that God brings that back into his mind. You look like a preacher. You know, God wants even ladies. Don't record this out of context. Ladies can be preachers. Where's Tori? Hi, Tori. Tori went to the jail. She's required to go there and give a sample every week at the jail. I'm just kidding. She works in the ministry there and had a chance to lead a lady to Christ in the jail. You know what she did? She preached, she proclaimed the gospel.
She practices at home.
Amen. That's her older brother. When you can proclaim the gospel to other ladies and help them get saved. You need to be involved in the ministry. You need to have a mission, and there needs to be manpower. You need to be part of the manpower. You know, there's so much that we could do. Can you imagine what would happen over there in Malawi if it's not forever. Just take a couple of months and go over there. Get your feet wet. Go during the rainy season and get your feet wet. Are you listening to this? And serve the Lord and see what God does in your heart. Mine eye affects my heart. There's many, many countries in Africa that are unreached. And anyway, ministry, the mission, we need manpower, and then we need money to send them. How can they preach except they be sent? Put a dollar sign there. How can they preach except they be sent? It costs money to buy plane tickets. It costs money to supply them in the field. they need a vehicle. I'm glad that the Malucci family, that large family, that you and I had the privilege of buying them a vehicle large enough for their family to travel around in on the mission field. I'm glad that we were able to buy your son, Mike O'Brien's son, John O'Brien. His wife has a bad back, and we're able to buy them a comfortable vehicle to ride around on those rough roads over there in the Ukraine. Yeah. I'm glad for that. That's a wonderful privilege that we have. How can they go except they be sent? How can they go and preach except they be sent? Now, when it comes to money, let's just get down to the nitty-gritty. God says 10% of all of your increase belongs to Him. Amen. It's not yours or mine to give. You don't give the tithe. The Bible never says that. The Bible says bring the tithe. The tithe is the Lord's. In fact, the Bible says the tithe is holy unto the Lord. You know, there are people who came to church today fully intended to rob from God. Fully intended to rob from God, but at the same time praying and asking God to help them in their home and help me in my marriage, help me in my family. Whoa. The same God you're robbing from? And by robbing and stealing are two different things. You get involved in are the Huffs here? Brother Huff? Cameron, he's into law enforcement. You'd look it up. Robbery is different than stealing. Robbery has the idea of taking it by force. Stealing, as if I'm some kind of an expert in stealing. But anyway, the tithe is the Lord's, 10% of all your increase. But if you're in the military and you get free housing, guess what? That's an increase. That's part of your salary. You ought to tithe on the value of that. Then after you bring the tithe, you can give an offering. And that's what we did for Dr. Davis. We gave an offering. The offering envelopes came by and we put some money in there. That's an offering. And thank God for that. But then there's a sacrifice. If I had time, I would read. You can read it later, all right? 2 Corinthians chapter 8. Just read the first 5 verses, all right? 2 Corinthians chapter 8. 2 Corinthians chapter 8. 2 Corinthians. Chapter 8, the first 5 verses. These churches, out of deep poverty and great persecution, deep poverty. I mean, the poor people said they were poor. Deep poverty and great persecution, tremendous trials. And yet, they begged the Apostle Paul to take an offering from them. That's a sacrificial offering. When you are destitute and poor, you're in deep poverty, anything you give is a sacrifice. Don't go away now. The Lord's tithe, you bring that to the Lord, then you give an offering, then you sacrifice, then over and above that, you give a grace offering. For the Bible says in 2 Corinthians chapter 8, they gave to their power, and then they gave beyond their power, beyond their ability. Now, when you give beyond your ability, that means God has to do something. Great truth that I learned on my knees is that God is the God of supply and God is the God of resupply. He gives you what you need, and then if you're willing to sacrifice and give by grace and give back to Him, He'll resupply you. I was preaching at a large church about missions, and I said, God's the God of supply, but God is also the God of resupply. The people broke in applause, applauding God. When Abraham was told to sacrifice his son, Abraham told his servants, the lad and I will return. And the New Testament explains that Abraham believed that God, if God allowed him to sacrifice his son, that God would resurrect his son. Which was an amazing thing, because up to that point there had been no resurrection in the Bible. But God's a God of supply and a God of resupply. Now here's the New Testament, Luke 6. You give and it shall be given unto you. Give and it shall be given unto you. If you wait until everything's comfortable for you to give, you're never going to give the way God wants you to give. Anybody can throw an offering in. Really, anybody can do that. Throw an offering in there. But it's when you begin to sacrifice And by the way, until you and I learn to sacrifice, we will never give a dime by faith.
Amen.
And only by faith pleases the Lord.
Right.
But until you and I learn to sacrifice, we'll never give a dime by faith or by grace, trusting that God, who gave it to me in the first place, will now resupply so that I can do this. Now, this is what 2 Corinthians says, that I may abound, that I may abound to every good work. You know, not so that you can give to every good work, but that you and I can abound to every good work. Dr. S.M. Davis said to me, Pastor, this church in Fairbanks is the most generous church I have ever experienced in all my travels. Now, I don't think you felt any pressure from the pulpit. We don't believe in guilt trips. We tell every preacher who comes here, we do not manipulate people at this church. We don't judge the quality of a sermon by how many people come to the altar. We're not here into manipulation. God's the one who has to work in their hearts. And the same thing is true with giving. We're not gonna twist your arm. That's painful. But you ever have God twist your arm? That's wonderful. And it still hurts. But the end result is blessing. It may not go the way you want it to go. This fellow from the sticks, he didn't get a very good education. He really never learned how to read and never learned much how to write. But he moved to the big city and needed to get a job. He used to live off the land. Now he needs to get a job. And he saw a sign at the First Baptist Church that they needed a janitor. And so he went in to ask where the pastor was and said, hey, listen, I need work. I'm willing to be a janitor. And he said, well, this is great timing. We need you right away. Can you start right away? Oh, yes, sir, I can start right away. He said, he'd just fill out this application and sign it and we'll put you to work. And he said, I can't do that. I said, no, it's not hard. You can do it. No, you don't understand. I don't know how to read or write. The pastor said, you don't know how to read or write? This is a really high church. This is a fancy church. I can't have somebody working here that doesn't know how to read or write. I'm sorry, sir. I can't have you work here. Boy, he was dejected, and he walked out hanging his head really low and walked down all the steps from that big church, and he had one quarter in his pocket. And he saw this vendor selling apples, 2 for a quarter. And so he bought 2 of them and sat on the curbstone, eating one and polishing up the other one. Somebody saw him sitting there and said, hey, I'll give you a quarter for that apple. And so he sold that apple for a quarter. And he thought, man, 50% profit is not bad. You'll figure that out later. So he went and bought more apples. And he walked, polished them up, and walked down and began. Instead, he bought them 2 for a quarter, and sent them 1 for a quarter. Pretty soon he said, you know, why don't I just have my own cart? So he went and built a cart and began to have other vegetables there and fruits there, and he began selling them, making a pretty good. Pretty soon he hired somebody to have another cart on another corner. Pretty soon he had several carts selling fruits and vegetables. Do you know it didn't take a whole lot of years? He opened his first little market in a storefront, a little market. Then pretty soon, a couple of years, he had a supermarket. And I mean things that he had several supermarkets. I mean, it's amazing what this guy did. But he kept all of his money in the mattress at home. $1 million. And back then, now that's a lot of money, but back then. And one of his friends said, you better put that in a bank. It's unsafe to keep that at your home. Well, I said, I suppose I should. So he went down to the bank and he asked to talk to the president of the bank, and the clerk said, well, the president's pretty busy, maybe I could just help you. And he said, well, I got $1 million I want to put in your bank. Her eyes got big as saucers. He said, I'll get the president right now, and went and got the president, brought him out. And he said, I understand you want to make a deposit. He said, yes, I have $1 million I want to put. $1 million? He saw the money in the several briefcases that he brought in. $1 million. Yes, sir. Yes, sir. We'll be glad to open up an account for you. Just fill out these cards and we're... He said, I can't do that. Well, why not? They're very simple. No, no, no. I never learned how to read or write. You don't know how to read or write, and you made $1 million? Where would you be today if you knew how to read and write? He said, I'd be the janitor down there at the First Baptist Church. Some doors may close of things that you think you want to do. Maybe it's because God's redirecting your life. You say, nothing I do seems to be successful. Maybe it's because God has a calling for you. A calling to take the gospel in its simplicity and yet in its power someplace else. I wonder how many of you would sit here today and say, Pastor Duffett, I'm so grateful that somebody had a burden for my soul and brought me the gospel. And if I'm telling you right now, preacher, if I died right where I'm seated today, I'm 100% sure I'm going to go to heaven. I know 100% for sure. I mean, for a Bible reason, I was born again. I have been saved and washed in the blood of the Lord Jesus. And I thank God when I die, I'm going to go to heaven because I've been saved. And I know for sure that that's true. Can I just see your hand held high in the air? Look at that. Look around here. Isn't that a wonderful sight? You can put your hand down. That may be that you're here today, a church member of our church or a member of some other church. But the truth is, you couldn't raise your hand honestly. You couldn't say, I know 100% for sure. You may be 70 or even 80%, and you certainly hope that when you die, you're going to go to heaven. But you don't know for sure. May I remind you, the Bible says, these things are written that ye may know that ye have eternal life. God not only wants to save you, but he wants you to know for sure that you're saved. The Bible says this. Jesus said, whoso cometh unto me, I will in no wise cast him out. Nobody ever came to Jesus wanting to be saved, willing to trust the Lord Jesus, and Jesus turned them aside and said, no, I don't want to save you. He wants all men to be saved and come to the knowledge of the truth. For whatever reason, God has placed you in this place today where you have been privileged to hear the truth. That salvation is not by works of righteousness that we have done, but according to his mercy, he saved us. That Jesus Christ paid the penalty for your sin. Hey, he took your place and my place on the cross of Jesus Christ. Our sins were placed upon him, and God took out his wrath and anger upon the Lord Jesus and wants to offer you the gift of God, which is eternal life through Jesus Christ our Lord. Would you stand together with me, please, quietly with our heads bowed in prayer? Father, how I pray that your Holy Spirit would have free reign in this place. I pray that you'd help the members of this church to catch the vision of preparing for our purpose. As we begin our missions revival next week, our purpose in taking the gospel to every creature. But I pray this morning for those who could not raise their hand just a minute ago that they knew 100% for sure that they were going to heaven. I'm sure that some raised their hand out of habit. Some raised their hand hoping that they were going to go to heaven. Some perhaps raised their hand because the people next to them did. But, oh God, would you please help us to be open and humble and honest before the dear Lord Jesus, that today might be the day of salvation for some. Our heads are bowed, our eyes are closed. I'm going to say the amen to that prayer in just a minute. Every head bowed and every eye closed. Nobody in the congregation looking around, please, just between you and me. I'd like to pray for you. If you're not 100% sure if you drop dead today and go to heaven, but you're smart enough to say, I don't want to go to hell, but I know I deserve to go to hell, I've sinned against a holy God. I've broken his commandments. I've sinned against my own conscience. I have violated the commandments of God that told me, thou shalt not steal, thou shalt not bear false witness, thou shalt not lie. Those commandments that said, honor thy father and thy mother. I've not done that. To remember the Sabbath day, to keep it holy, to love the Lord thy God with all of our heart, soul, mind, and strength. I've not done that. Thou shalt not covet. I have coveted. If thou look upon a woman to lust, you've committed adultery in your heart. I'm guilty before you. Oh God, I'm guilty. I'm guilty. But I don't want to go to hell. If I could be forgiven, if I could be saved, if I could be reconciled to God, that's my greatest need this morning. Pastor Duffett, would you pray for me that I could be saved and know for sure that I'm saved, that I'd be able to put my head on my pillow tonight and know that if I should die before I woke, that I'd be forever with the Lord. Pastor Duffett, don't embarrass me. Don't call out my name. Please don't send somebody back to bother me during this service. But please, Pastor Duffett, would you pray for me? I don't want to die and go to hell. And I'd like so much, I need so much to know that my sins are forgiven and that heaven will be my home. Our heads are bowed, our eyes are closed. Now, no one's looking around in the congregation. No one's looking around. Would you let me pray for you? Preacher, would you please remember my name and my need before your own private prayer closet and pray for me that I'd be saved before it's too late? Our heads are bowed, our eyes are closed. Lift your hand high in the air. You'll know when I see your hand. I'm watching for you. Maybe things haven't gone so well in your life because God wanted you to be here, to hear the gospel, and to be saved. Preacher, pray for me. I don't want to die and go to hell. I need a Savior. Please pray for me. Slip your hand up high. You'll know when I see your hand. Slip your hand up high. I'm watching all over the auditorium. I'm watching for you. You may have been raised in a Christian home, and you've tried to do what's right, but salvation is not by works. It's not by living right and doing right. God saves those that are repentant. A change of mind, taking God's side against my sin, and me admitting that I need a Savior. Preacher, I just want to know God, but I don't know for sure. Or maybe you say, I know for sure if I died right now, I'd go to hell, but I don't want to go to hell. Pastor, would you pray? Slip your hand up high. I'm watching for you. Here's the last call. Here's the last call. Slip your hand up high. You'll know when I see your hand. You'll know when I see your hand. And I promise you I'll pray. And I believe God hears and answers my prayers. I'd like to pray for you. We have an altar. For this morning, the altar is for people who say, I want to be involved in the ministry. I want to get enlisted in the mission of this church. I don't want to be a bystander. I want to enlist in the Great Commission efforts of this church. I want to pray for manpower, that God would send forth laborers into his work. And I'm going to ask God to help me to learn how to tithe and to give and to sacrifice and to give by faith. I want to be a good giver just like God is a good giver to me. I want to give that others might hear. The step to the platform, a place of prayer, a place to say to God, God, I heard what you said to me through the Word of God today. Now would you please help me and use me? Father, I pray you draw to yourself those that are listening to your Spirit. I pray in Jesus' name, amen.